The Hypershocker. It's a bike that I've been wanting to revisit, at least in conversation, for a while now because, well, there are a few reasons, but believe it or not, the Shocker is a special bike to me. Now, I think most of us will agree that the Hypershocker, it's anything but stellar if you look at the components. And that sans possibly the most featherweight of riders, it's not going to last that long on a mountain bike trail. And that was my introduction to the Shocker, and how I approached it was as an actual mountain bike, riding it on actual mountain bike trails. And to get from that point to today, I need to do a bit of backstory. KevCentral is a YouTube channel that actually started in 2016. Now, I know if you look on the About, it says 2011, but that's when I created my YouTube account so I could subscribe to other people's videos and comment and so on. But when I actually started uploading my own videos, my own random reviews, was in 2016. And it took another year, till 2017, before I did my first bike review on the Trek Dual Sport 1. That was in March of 2017. Well, in June of 2017, I got a friend's Hypershocker and I took it to a mountain bike trail and I made a video on that. And I didn't know it at the time, but that kicked off a series of videos that would end up being the KevCentral we have today. And that Shocker video, to this very day, I get comments and emails on it, some saying I was too harsh on the bike. Now, I'll admit that at that time, I had a less than favorable opinion of any bike that came from Walmart or any other big box store. Now, obviously, my opinion on big box bikes in general has evolved, well, a lot. And if it weren't for that Shocker, I wouldn't have found the Schwinn Boundary and eventually the Mongoose XR Pro and everything else. And looking back, a lot of what I said is still valid. For an adult rider looking for a mountain bike to ride on an actual mountain bike trail, this is not the best choice, really, not even a safe choice. But let's talk realities about the Shocker and bikes like it and in the same price range. Because I would say that Walmart shoppers that would actually intend to take this onto a mountain bike trail, they're rare. I would say to almost every buyer, it's just a cool looking bike that they're going to ride on the street. So to the Shocker owners that say I pushed the bike beyond what it should be used for, well, you are correct, but I will point to those info cards, the hang tags, that say things like rough terrain and downhill trails. I still wish they would change those, because even though it's rare that someone could expect these to survive on a mountain bike trail, I mean, what you don't know, you don't know. And that's why there's a KevCentral, a place we can come to find out what big box bikes can do in their factory form and which ones can grow over time with upgrades, or grow with us as our skills and needs increase. So now, after 2 years of making these videos, if you were to ask me if my opinion is the same on the Hypershocker, well, no it's not. Because 2 years ago, if you would have asked me if this was an okay bike for the average person just riding it around town, I would have probably said no, because I was looking at it through the lens of someone that compared everything to a Trek, because that's what I rode at the time. But over time, I've grown to respect certain big box bikes and what they can become. Now, that doesn't mean I would buy a Shocker, because it doesn't meet my standards for what I want a big box bike to be able to do in the future. But that's for me. I see Shockers and bikes like it being ridden locally on a daily basis. As a matter of fact, yesterday I was in Nashville, Tennessee, and I saw a guy on his brand new Hyper Havoc. If you don't know what a Havoc is, it's basically a Hypershocker with an aluminum frame. It costs $24 more. I could see the joy on that guy's face, and I could tell he was proud of his new bike. Do you remember earlier in this video when I said, you know what you know? Well, that applies to me too, because now I know that bikes like this Shocker are not necessarily bad. They're useful within their own domain, but you need to know as a buyer what that domain is. Rough terrain and downhill trails, like it says on that info card, are definitely not it, and that's what's reflected in my original video on the Shocker. So let me round all this up by restating what I think about the Shocker and bikes like it. Number one is that any bike can be fun in the right situation. So if you have one of these, enjoy it and have that fun. Just don't expect it to hold up well if you jump it around on a mountain bike trail. Number two is you don't have to spend big bucks on a bike. If you want to do basic things like ride down the road, it doesn't take much to get that accomplished. So even a cheap bike can do it. Now that said, the cheaper a bike is, the more often it is to likely need maintenance and repairs, so factor that in. Number three is don't worry with what other people think, really including me, and I'm saying that in reference to the emails and messages that I get, because if you like a bike's style and it makes you happy, then be happy. And a hidden bonus, if you do buy a big box bike, you may be sparing it from the torture of the Walmart Garden Center corner of misery. a place bikes go to pre-rust, and I have no idea why they do this to new bikes, but at this particular Walmart, this is like 10 feet from a covered overhang. And there you have it, my slightly changed perspective on bikes like the Hypershocker a few years later. Now I want to hear from you. I want your perspective on big box bikes. Has it changed over time? And did the upgrade videos that I've done on some of the big box bikes, did that change your viewpoint? I'm curious to hear what you have to say, so comment below and let me know. Thanks to everyone for watching, and have a great day.